Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining the 10th Mama Charitable Foundation Lecture Series in Buddhist Studies. The theme of the series is Buddhism and Senses. We're very happy and honored to have invited Professor Donald Lopez from the University of Michigan, together with four distinguished scholars, to conduct this lecture series. Today, Dr. Lina Verchery from Victoria University of Wellington we deliver the fourth lecture of the series, and she will talk about the sense of smell. Before the lecture begins, I would like to invite Professor Donald Lopez, the 10th Mama Charitable Foundation Visiting Professor in Buddhist Studies of HKU and other E-Link Distinguished University Professor of Buddhist and Tibetan Studies of the University of Michigan to welcome and introduce today's speaker. Professor Lopez, please.
Thank you for the kind introduction. It's my pleasure to introduce the fourth of seven lectures on the topic of Buddhism and the senses, a lecture series hosted by the Center of Buddhist Studies at the University of Hong Kong with the generous support of the Mama Charitable Foundation. Let me say something about how this lecture series came about. In 2017, the National Museum of Asian Art of the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C., opened a major exhibition of Buddhist art consisting entirely of pieces from its own Freer and Sackler galleries. Generously supported by the Robert H. N. Ho Family Foundation, the exhibition was called Encountering the Buddha. Like many major exhibitions of art, it was decided that the show should produce a scholarly volume. These have traditionally been beautifully illustrated art books. However, with so much of the greatest Buddhist art, including the entire collection of the National Museum of Asian Art, now available to us with just a few clicks on our laptop, it was decided to do something different. The arts are things that we experience through our senses, the sense of sight for the visual arts, the sense of hearing for the musical arts, the senses of smell and taste for the culinary arts, and the sense of touch for the erotic arts. Buddhism is renowned for its disparagement and suspicion of sense experience, for its sense skepticism, as a philosopher would say. And yet, Buddhism has made major contributions to each of these arts, the visual, the musical, the culinary, and the erotic. Why not explore this dilemma? In July 2021, a group of 10 scholars of Buddhism met via Zoom with the National Museum of Asian Art staff for a two-day workshop with two scholars presenting on each of the five senses. The essays that resulted from that workshop will be published by Wisdom Publications next year in a book called, as you might expect, Buddhism and the Senses. The fourth lecture in this seven-lecture University of Hong Kong series on the sense of smell will be given by Professor Lina Verchery of Victoria University in New Zealand, a scholar of Chinese Buddhism. The fifth lecture on the sense of taste will be given by Professor James Robson of Harvard University, a scholar of Chinese and Japanese Buddhism. The sixth lecture on the sense of touch will be given by Professor Reiko Onuma of Dartmouth College, a scholar of Indian Buddhism. The series will conclude with a final lecture by me. It's my pleasure now to introduce Dr. Lina Verchery of the School of Social and Cultural Studies at Victoria University in New Zealand. She's a scholar of Chinese Buddhism and an independent filmmaker who specializes in the ethnographic study of contemporary Buddhist monastic life in China and throughout the Chinese diaspora. Lina holds a PhD in Buddhist studies from Harvard University. Her doctoral dissertation was entitled Impersonal Intimacy, Paradoxes of Monastic Sociality in a Transnational Buddhist Network. It is a multi-sided ethnographic study of sociality, interspecies ethics, and everyday moral cultivation based on over 10 years of fieldwork in Taiwan, Hong Kong, Malaysia, Australia, Canada, and the United States. Her teaching and research center on how the histories, philosophies, and practices of Buddhism can illuminate modern questions of urgent concern. She teaches and publishes about the intersection of Buddhism and art, ecology, and interspecies ethics. Lina is also executive editor of the Yincheng Journal of Contemporary Buddhism. In addition to all of this, she's an award-winning filmmaker who has produced several documentary and multimedia works as part of her ethnographic research. Her documentary, experimental, and educational films about Buddhism and connected topics have been screened in festivals and on television networks around the world. It's my great pleasure now to introduce Dr. Lina Verchery, who will discuss the sense of smell.
Hello, everyone. Kia ora. I'm Lina Verchery. I'm a lecturer in Buddhist studies here at Te Haerenga Waka, the Victoria University of Wellington in New Zealand, Aotearoa. I'm very happy to be here today. I'm so enjoying this lecture series. Thank you so much to the University of Hong Kong and to the organizers. It's also been a real delight to reunite with my fellow contributors to the Buddhism and the Senses volume. As you'll recall from Don Lopez's remarks, that project brings together a volume of essays in which each essay explores the good dimension and bad dimension of one of the five human senses according to Buddhism. So for that project, I wrote not about Buddhism and smell in general, but about Buddhism and bad smell specifically. So that will be the topic of today's talk. I should also say that I'm actually not sure if I should feel honored or insulted that when my esteemed colleagues were thinking of who should write about bad smell, they for some reason thought of me. I just now I wear a bit more perfume than I used to wear. But regardless of whether the smells in question are good or bad, one thing we can absolutely say is that smell itself, what we might call the olfactory imaginaire, absolutely pervades the world of Buddhism, right? This is true in Buddhist literature and scripture. To give you just a few examples, we can think of how in Buddhism, as in many world religions actually, miraculous or auspicious events are often foreshadowed by the appearance of a fragrance, a sweet-smelling fragrance. We could point to the larger Sukhavati Vyuha Sutra, right? The Fo Shuo U Liang Shuo Jing, which describes the paradisiacal pure land of Amitabha Buddha, not just as a place of visual beauty, but of olfactory beauty, right? Describing it as suffused with 10,000 kinds of delicate fragrance. Even Shakyamuni Buddha, who the tradition says always emitted this extraordinary fragrance and never smelled bad, and even as a fetus, was said to have gestated in a Gandha Kutagara, a fragrance chamber or kind of perfumed womb inside the body of his mother, Queen Maya. We should note that smell is central in Buddhism, not only in, you know, literature and scripture, but also in the world of everyday Buddhist practice. As many of you in the audience undoubtedly know, one of the first things you notice when you step foot in a Buddhist temple or monastery is the incredible fragrance of, you know, the incense wafting throughout the space. You see the altars covered in fragrant offerings of food and flowers. And if you're familiar with the Chinese Buddhist monastic schedule, you might also know that every ritual day, right, in the monastery actually begins with the recitation of the Bao Ding San. This is the jeweled censer praise, a kind of sung invocation of this extraordinary cosmic smellscape, right? This like incredible sweet cloud of fragrance that envelops the cosmos. But I'm sorry to say, olfaction in Buddhism is not limited to pleasant fragrances such as these. Actually, when it comes to the significance of smell in human culture, many would argue that it's actually, from a biological perspective anyway, bad smells that play the more significant role. Evolutionary psychologists, for instance, argue that our natural human aversion to foul-smelling substances is actually an evolved trait, you know, designed to protect us from contact with substances that could contain pathogens or parasites that would make us sick, right? So like excrement and open wound and rotting organic matter and decomposing corpses. But this biological explanation fails to address the many subjective and contextual ways that we ascribe meaning to smell. So let me give you a personal example to illustrate what I mean. By the way, here we have an outline of today's talk. You can feel free to follow along if you would like to. So as some of you may have gleaned from my surname, Verchery, my family background is French. One thing that French people really love is cheese. And I don't know if any of you have had this experience before, but if you don't happen to grow up in a household where you are accustomed to eating very pungent French cheeses like Camembert or Roquefort or Epoisse, it may be the case that if you are presented with a platter of ripe, artisanal, beautiful French cheese, you may not actually have the mouth-watering anticipatory response, but instead you might be overcome with disgust at the smell. In fact, you might even find yourself saying a phrase that I've heard people utter many, many times in my life, that French cheeses smell just like stinky, rancid, unwashed feet. But this is where it gets very, very interesting. So it turns out that the bacterial cultures that are used, essential for ripening French cheeses like Epoisse or Munster or Brie, this bacterial culture, specifically called Brevibacterium linens, is what creates that famous funky odor of French cheeses. And it is the exact same bacteria that can be found feeding on sweat and dead skin cells in between the toes of human feet. And actually, it's the digestive waste of these bacteria that produces the ammoniac odor that is so characteristic of stinky feet. So when folks complain that French cheese reminds them of stinky feet, actually, it turns out this is not hyperbole. It is, in fact, molecularly speaking, empirically accurate, right? Because the very same bacteria produce the smell in both cases. And so this begs the question, how can it be that an odor that is so relished in one context can be so reviled in another? In other words, what is bad about bad smell? So in today's lecture, in which actually I should apologize in advance, there will be lots of disgusting discussions of gross things. I also apologize, as you may have already gleaned from my slides, there will be no shortage of profanity. I'm quite delighted by all of this. So in today's lecture, we are going to plumb what Buddhism has to say in response to this question. What exactly is bad about bad smell? And to give you a sneak peek, it's going to raise what I think are some remarkable implications about everything from morality and ethics to embodiment and materiality to sociality, you know, leading us directly into an interstitial space where mind meets body, culture meets biology, the symbolic meets the material. I will argue that smell, in the Buddhist sources that we'll look at today, reveals who and what we are, pointing to the inescapable truth of our existential situation. This can make bad smells dangerous. But we shall also see in the ethnographic case study from my own work, with which this lecture will conclude, that this is also the source of potential insight and revelation. I should also note that it's not lost on me, in the early stages of the writing and research on which today's lecture is based, we found ourselves in the midst of a global pandemic, in which people all around me, and probably people all around you, were falling ill with COVID-19 and losing their sense of taste and smell, right? We seldom appreciate or even realize the crucial role that olfaction plays in our daily lives for everything from enjoying, you know, our ability to enjoy food, to the sense of intimacy that we have embracing a loved one or a beloved pet. But smell is utterly central in many of the experiences that connect us with others and with the world around us. So I'm hoping that today we can bring this kind of sensitivity to the lecture as well. You know, the sense that the things we're going to talk about and learn about bad smell in Buddhism are not just relevant in theory or relevant for Buddhists of the distant past, but that also hold potential to illuminate aspects of our own lived experience and embodied existence today. So let's begin. Smell as a moral diagnostic. There's a beautiful passage in the Confucian Kongzi Jiayu, which reads, "Being in the company of virtuous people is like entering a room full of orchids. After a while, you no longer notice the fragrance because you have been immersed in it. Being in the company of bad people is like entering a fish shop. After a while, you no longer notice the stench because you have been immersed in it." So this passage not only makes a poetic parallel between smell and social connection, which is actually a topic we will return to in a few moments when we talk about smell and sociality, but it also makes a salient point, I think, that perhaps some of us already kind of intuit from our everyday experience. To paraphrase a line from the Buddhist philosopher Nishitani Keiji, who once mused on the paradox that the eye cannot see the eye, right? The eye can see, but it doesn't see itself. Here we might say, the smeller can smell, but they cannot smell themselves, right? Most of the time, it's not so hard to recognize the smells of those around us, but it's actually much harder to recognize our own smells, right? So in this sense, smell becomes a striking metaphor for the many things that others can notice about us and our character, but which we don't recognize about ourselves, right? So smell reveals things that we don't know, as also related in this very uplifting line from the Zen commentarial collection, specifically it's case 77 of the Blue Cliff Record, in which the monk Yuan Wu exclaims that Master Xue Do doesn't notice the smell of his own shit. So there are a few ways that we could read this, actually. Most obviously, perhaps Xue Do, like many of us, is able to see the faults of others but fails to see the faults in himself, like he cannot recognize the smell of his own shit. But as Victor Hori has also proposed, one might espouse a Zen non-dual reading of this passage, whereby, like not recognizing the smell of your own shit, Xue Do doesn't recognize his own Buddha nature. But whether it's shit or Buddha nature, we still have to ask, why does smell have this revelatory potential, this revelatory capacity? One reason might connect to something that Constance Klassen evokes in her book Aroma, A Cultural History of Smell. She writes that through smell, one interacts with interiors rather than with surfaces. So in a sense, smell goes more than skin deep, right? Unlike sight or even touch, right, which settle on surfaces, smell sort of suggests interiors and essences, kind of revealing depths that are not always accessible to the other senses. We find that smell has this revelatory capacity in the Buddhist sources as well, right? Where smells operate as a powerful moral diagnostic. In her study of Shantideva's Compendium of Training, Suzanne Rosick writes how beings can literally stink with sin, or be perfumed with virtues. In a contemporary illustration of a similar idea, the 20th century monk Xuanhua writes in his commentary to the Avatamsaka Sutra, "People who uphold precepts always smell good." This is a great advice if anyone, you know, it's a great way to improve your odor. "People who uphold precepts always smell good. No matter how many days they go without bathing, they still do not stink. Their bodies naturally emit a pleasant odor." And conversely, he continues, by punning on the Chinese character many of you will know for arrogance, this word zida, right? Arrogance, which if you arrange these characters vertically, it begins to resemble the character for stench, cho, or qiu, right? So he continues, "What is stench? It is arrogance, zida. If you add a dot, if you look at the character cho for stench, it's a zi and a da with a little dian in the middle, little dot in the middle. To regard oneself as very grand. Now that is what I call stench. So here, moral failings, character flaws, like arrogance and narcissism and self-aggrandizement, quite literally stink. We might also add that smell in Buddhism is more than just a sign of a person's moral virtues or failings in the present moment. It also connects on a much deeper level to the undergirding karmic conditions through time that give rise to those kinds of characteristics. Buddhist literature is full of poetic parallels between smell and karma, right? So firstly, consider how karma generally has obvious effects, but unknown causes, right? At least to those of us who are unenlightened. Of course, the characteristic of a fully awakened Buddha is that they finally know all of their past karma, right? They finally see the karmic causes that led to the present karmic effects. But for the rest of us unawakened people, I'll just speak for myself, I won't presume for anyone here in the audience, but for those of us who are unawakened, we often see the effects of karma, but we can't necessarily recognize the causes, right? In a similar way, we often recognize an odor without necessarily being able to pinpoint the source of that odor. Now, how many times have you gone into your kitchen or house and said, where is that smell coming from, right? But this distance between the odor and the odorant, so between the odor that you can perceive diffuse in the space and the odorant that is the cause or source of the smell, this distance is actually one of the reasons why smell is such an effective metaphor for the notion of karma, right? Which we could maybe more precisely describe as karmic habituation or karmic patterning, what in Sanskrit is called vasana, shichiji in Chinese, habituated karmic dispositions. Shichiji or vasana are habituated karmic patterns that we carry forward from our past lives, right? And this word, vasana, is closely connected with this other word, vasana, with a short a at the end, which means to perfume, or enfleurage. This is another beautiful word we have from French perfumery. Enfleurage describes the process in perfume production whereby an odor can pass from one medium, the odorant, into a new medium, right? So for example, if you have rose petals and you put them in oil, right? At the end, what you have is an essential oil that preserves the scent of the rose petals, but you've discarded the actual rose petals, right? So no petals remain, but you just have the scent alone that remains. So this is called enfleurage. So in the same way, right? By the way, you can read more about this in James McHugh's wonderful book on the topic. So in the same way that in the fabrication of perfume, odorant molecules pass from one medium to another, right? From rose petals to oil, for example, habituated karmic seeds of our past lives, vasana, right? Are said to perfume, vasana, our present, right? Giving rise to our present dispositions. So in this sense, scent, no pun intended. In this sense, scent becomes, at least metaphorically, a bridge between past and present, right? Explaining how karma can unfold through time without having to presuppose any kind of reified essence or any kind of reified self. As we shall see, this metaphor actually rests on what I find to be one of smell's most intriguing and unique properties. Namely, its ambivalent materiality. Reaching boundaries, ambivalent materiality. So I suggest that one of the reasons smell is so extraordinary is because it sits right at the cusp of several salient conceptual categories. As we saw in the case of vasana and vasana, smell acts as a bridge between past and present, right? We'll see in a moment that according to the Buddhist thinker Vasubandhu, it also sits at the cusp of what he calls contact and distance. Or, as we'll talk about right now, it also sits right at the cusp of the material and the immaterial. And this latter pair, materiality and immateriality, actually plays a very important role in the way smell functions in everyday Buddhist practice. I'll say more about that in a moment. Much of the pre-modern Buddhist thinking about the nature and science of smell is drawn from the ancient Indian sources, where smells are characterized as a decidedly material particle, right? So a smell is thought to be a physical particle, but one that is so small, so minute, that it can be carried invisibly on the wind. So unlike grosser forms of matter, such as objects of touch, right, or objects of taste, which are material, but they are physically stable and cannot move of their own accord, smell, though it is also a material particle, can move as though it is immaterial, right? Much more like sight or hearing can move through the air. The material liminality of odors, located right at this cusp between the material and the immaterial, makes smell a quintessential boundary crosser. And I'll say more about that in an instant. As Vasubandhu elaborates in the Abhidharma Kosha, this enables smell to bridge so-called contact and distance senses. So contact senses, Vasubandhu explains, are those senses that require physical contact with the sense object in order to generate perception, right? So like touch or taste are great examples. You have to actually come into contact, physical contact with the sense object in order to have the sensation, right? These are in contrast to sight and hearing, which are distance senses, right? In other words, for sight and hearing, you can have a sensory perception without physical proximity to the sense object, right? You can see things at a distance. You can hear things at a distance. But smell, once again, here is liminal. While the materiality, right, the particulate nature, the materiality of olfaction places it in the category of contact senses, right? To inhale a smell is to bring physical particles of the odorant into contact with your sense organ, so it's a contact sense. Olfaction can also operate from afar, operate at a distance, like vision and hearing. So as James McHugh notes, smell is in fact the only sense that allows one to partake of an object's particles at a distance. This bridge between what Vasubandhu calls contact and distance, or what we might maybe even more accurately call contact at a distance, gives smell a special mediatory power. Let me give you a very commonplace everyday example. Consider the Buddhist practice of making offerings. So in Buddhism, as in pre-Buddhist Vedic religion, it is smell that is believed to invisibly carry the material particles of an offering, whether it's a bowl of fragrant food or, you know, a stick of incense, carry the particles of that offering from an altar here in the human realm up to the celestial abodes of the Buddhas or Bodhisattvas or ancestors or whoever is the recipient of the offering. And because it is the smell, often in the form of fragrant steam or smoke, that carries those particles to be enjoyed at a distance, it comes as no surprise that the items typically selected for religious offerings are those that have very fragrant qualities, right? Flavorful food, fragrant flowers, sweet-smelling incense. I can give you an ethnographic anecdote of this logic at work. One day when I was doing my fieldwork assisting a Buddhist nun in her daily round of making offerings before all of the Buddhas and Bodhisattva statues in the temple, we were delivering, you know, fruits and, you know, bowls of rice and packets of crackers and chips kind of sealed in plastic. And before delivering each one, the nun asked me to cut a small slit in each one of the packaged items, right? In order to let the smell out, right? Because without cutting a little hole, the smell would remain trapped inside the bag, preventing the offering from reaching its intended recipient. So this ability to cross boundaries, to operate at a distance, gives smell, I would argue, a unique mediatory power. But on the topic of crossing boundaries, if, as the anthropologist Mary Douglas famously wrote, dirt is defined as matter out of place, then the propensity to cross boundaries also carries the risk of contamination. Right? It's because smell is a material particle that to inhale a scent is to actually physically bring particles of the odorant into one's body, inside one's body. And so, right, like whereas sight and touch can keep the sense object separate from the self, smell, like taste, brings it inside. As such, smell blurs another important boundary, and that is the boundary between inside and outside, self and other. So, whether they smell of orchids or fish, as we saw earlier, the influence of others, like their scent, leaves an imprint on us. And in this respect, smell then becomes a metaphor for the inescapability of social relationship. And indeed, this principle is actually not merely metaphorical, but it's also deeply pragmatic, since managing smell is also actually part of managing community, a point we see amply illustrated in the Buddhist Vinayas. Relationships are in part regulated through smell, whether we consciously realize it or not. And the social dimensions of smell were certainly recognized by the authors and compilers of the Buddhist Vinayas and of the later Chinese monastic purity rules, right, the Qingui. In her study of these texts, Anne Herrmann makes a very interesting observation that although in today's modern discourse, we might explain the Vinaya's preoccupation with controlling human smells in terms of maintaining public hygiene or in terms of public health, she actually says that the monastic rules frame smell management explicitly in terms of sociality, emphasizing the collective and institutional importance of smell control. Managing one's smell, we learn from the Vinaya, is not something one does for oneself. It's actually something one does for others. Conforming, then, to collective conventions of how one should or should not smell, thus becomes a performative affirmation of one's belonging and participation in the group. So in this sense, if we again ask, what is bad about bad smell? Well, one answer could be that to veer away from socially sanctioned olfactory expectations, in other words, to smell bad, is not merely a personal choice, but actually becomes a symbolic rejection of the social order. Let's consider a few examples. Let me warn you, this is about to get really gross. So the Buddhist monastic rules, as you find in the Vinaya, evince concern with all of the usual suspects, right? Urine, feces, flatulence. You'll be grateful that in my boundless compassion, I did not feel the need to give you visual aids for any of these substances that I am listing. I trust you can use your imagination. The rules dictate that monastics may not urinate or defecate or fart near a stupa, lest the smell defile the monument. Elsewhere, we read that human and animal excrement must be dutifully swept up every day to avoid, quote, assailing people's nostrils. There's also rules about where latrines can be built on the monastic compound, namely downwind, right? So that the smell of the toilets doesn't like come in and contaminate the entire monastic complex. We also find instructions about chewing toothwood to control bad breath, and in fact, also using fragrant mud to deodorize the body. I would point you again to Anne Herrmann's wonderful work on this topic if you'd like to read more. Deodorizing the body, the problem of body odor, becomes an even graver concern when the bodies in question are no longer alive. Cremations, for example, we read, are forbidden in the vicinity of a stupa, lest the foul-smelling odor penetrate the sacred space. Right, so keeping foul smells separate from the sacred space. But this is very hard to do for monks who practice austerities in cremation grounds, right, which is a form of Buddhist asceticism. Though such monks may be lauded for their ascetic accomplishments, in the Vinaya we read that they are in fact shunned for their foul smell. Because of the stench produced by the funerary shrouds, right, that they collect in the cremation grounds to wear as robes as part of their ascetic practice, the Mulasarvastivada Vinaya forbids such monks from approaching a stupa, from preaching to lay people, from participating in ceremonies, or from even entering the monastic dorms. Actually, the text literally says, you have to stand outside the door, right? You smell too terrible. You have to wait outside. Because of their rank odor, these monks are also not allowed to rejoin collective life unless they follow a series of important steps and rules. Namely, they have to thoroughly bathe themselves, they have to fumigate with incense, they have to also set out their freshly washed robes to sun in the forest and air out for 7 to 8 days until the smell has fully dissipated. And only then may these monks rejoin collective life. Keeping smells at bay is essential not only for preserving the harmony among monastic residents, but it was also crucial, if not more important, for upholding the dignified image of the Sangha among the general public, right? And especially among those lay patrons upon whom the monastery relies for its livelihood. We repeatedly read throughout the texts that bad smell damages the Sangha's reputation and drives people away. The Mahayana Mahaparinirvana Sutra, for instance, warns that garlic breath produces a dirty smell that is unbearable and causes others to leave that person and go away. Indeed, we read that such smells do not merely repel potential economic benefactors, but also spiritual benefactors as well. Since Buddhas and Bodhisattvas are repulsed by the foul breath of humans, many sutra recitations actually begin with a dharani to purify the mouth, right? According to the Dabicho Sanchen Weiyi, the 3000 regulations for great bhikshus, foul-smelling monastics are not allowed to worship the triple jewel, participate in rituals, or approach the abbot. And should they do so anyway, their otherwise meritorious activities will accrue no merit at all on account of their bad smell. This is very bad. This is very bad. So the repulsive effect of foul odor once again illustrates the social significance of smell. What is bad about bad smell, in other words, is that it thwarts beneficial relationships. Indeed, the converse is also true. It attracts undesirable relationships. Writings on garlic and the famous pungent vegetables, right, the wuxin, make this especially clear. One example is hungry ghosts. Okay, so hungry ghosts don't just stink. Actually, you know, they themselves physically smell very bad, but they're also attracted to other things that smell bad, just like they themselves do, right? So they're attracted to urine, they're attracted to feces, and they're especially attracted to garlic breath. In his commentary on the Dharmaguptaka Vinaya, the Song Dynasty Vinaya scholar Yuan Zhao warns that if a person eats garlic, Hungry ghosts will be attracted by the stench and linger at their lips. The person's merit will erode daily, and their actions will never bring benefit. To this already grim prognosis, Yuan Zhao adds this especially lecherous detail, which is that ghosts find garlic breath so irresistible that they won't merely hover near that person's mouth. They will actually passionately lick and kiss the person's mouth and lips. Gross. So this, I suggest, illuminates another facet of what makes bad smell bad. It seems to act as a gateway into graver forms of moral transgression. So in the example of Yuan Zhao, just a moment ago, we can say that bad breath is doubly transgressive, right? Not only does it attract unsavory relations, right? You smell bad, and so hungry ghosts want to hang out with you. So thereby it constitutes a kind of social transgression. But on top of it, the very nature of those social relations is itself problematic, because it starts to veer from a social transgression toward a sexual transgression, right? With the ghosts not merely hanging near you, but passionately kissing and licking and making out with your mouth. The Vinaya includes other examples of bad smell as a gateway to or a correlate of broader moral transgression. One of the many reasons that the five pungent smelling vegetables, which of course prominently include garlic, are problematic is because they are associated with loss of control and self-restraint, right? So much that figures like the formidable Vinaya commentators Dao Xuan and Dao Shi routinely treat these pungent vegetables in the same category as alcohol, right? Another forbidden substance which occasions a loss of control and self-restraint. On this topic, moreover, in the first Paccitya section of the Bhikkhuni Vibhanga of the Pali Vinaya, we find the famous, or maybe I should say infamous, story of the nun Tulananda, right, who developed such an obsession with stinky garlic that she led all of her fellow nuns to steal the entire crop of garlic from a nearby, you know, layperson's field. So we see that her love for this famously stinky vegetable led her to also violate one of the core precepts in Buddhism against theft, right? Doubly transgressive. I would suggest that we might even detect sexualized undertones in this story, insofar as the Vinaya treats this out of control obsession with garlic, right, which is also, we should note, widely considered, was considered and continues to be considered an aphrodisiac in South Asia and East Asia, as a primarily female vulnerability. Whereas garlic consumption by monks is a mere dukkata, right, a light or minor offense, the very same act, if committed by nuns, is punished as a paccitika, right? A violation requiring confession, more serious. And Herman notes that the Vinaya justifies the more severe punishment for women on the basis of their, quote, insatiable longing for the foul-smelling plant, leading me to wonder, whether this specifically female tendency for insatiable longing might imply a predisposition to other sorts of insatiabilities as well. Indeed, the connection between smell and sexuality is not as far-flung as it might at first appear. Sex, after all, like smell, is the crossing of a boundary between self and other, right? So insofar as the goal of the Vinaya is the clear elucidation of boundaries, right, especially this all-important boundary between the permitted and the forbidden, it stands to reason that smell, which as we've seen is a boundary crosser, right, a quintessential boundary crosser, can be dangerous and risky. This danger is perhaps nowhere more acute than in what we might describe as the most extreme form of interpersonal boundary crossing, namely eating meat, the physical act of taking another's body into one's own. Although eating meat, we should note, is not technically forbidden in the Vinaya, and nor is it forbidden in several branches of Buddhism, in China, we do have evidence that vegetarianism became the standard possibly as early as the 3rd century CE, at least for Buddhist clergy. But what is so surprising in the arguments in the East Asian sources against meat eating is the fact that they are so frequently framed in terms of smell rather than taste, as you might expect when dealing with food, right, and eating. Moreover, the smells in question are rarely the smells of the meat, but actually the smells of the meat eater. The Lankavatara Sutra, for instance, characterizes meat eaters as ill-smelling, contemptuous, born deprived of intelligence. The Mahayana Mahaparinirvana Sutra would elaborate on this theme, saying that any being who smells a meat eater will become afraid and filled with the fear of death. So the smell of meat eaters clearly inspires terror. But we should ask, what precisely is the nature of this terror? Most obviously, from the Mahaparinirvana Sutra, we can say it's the smell of death, right? But on a deeper level, I would suggest that we can describe it as the violation of proper relations. The fact that the horror of meat eating is so prevalently framed in terms of smell rather than taste, I would like to suggest, tells us something very significant about relationality and the unique semiotics of smell. So as we've seen, the hallmark of olfaction is the way it crosses boundaries between past and present, distance and contact, materiality and immateriality, inside and outside, self and other. Meat eating is perhaps the most extreme form of boundary crossing, right? In which two subjects don't merely come into temporary contact, but one completely subsumes the other, right? So the horror of meat, in other words, is not just the violence of killing. It's actually an act of relational subjugation, relational violence. Consider, for instance, the popular verse about the famous Liang Dynasty Buddhist monk Zhigong. He's also sometimes known as Bao Zhi. So one day, Zhigong is at a wedding, having a great time. But then suddenly, he exclaims, "How strange, how bizarre. The grandson marries the grandmother, and the daughter eats the mother's flesh. The drum the son beats is stretched with the father's skin. Pigs and sheep are on the seat, and the 6 close kin, family members in other words, are cooking in the brazier. The people gather to celebrate, but I see all this as a form of suffering." Now, I've been to some crazy weddings. Never anything quite this bad. Okay, so the grandson marries the grandmother. In a flash of insight, right, Zhigong saw that the groom's deceased grandmother had so loved her grandson that she ended up reborn as his wife-to-be, right? The bride's father had been reborn as the deer who was killed to make the drum, and the pig being feasted upon was the bride's own mother, reborn as a pig, right? So the daughter eats the mother's flesh. Interestingly, the horror of this scene is not framed in terms of the violence of killing, right? I would argue it actually doesn't dwell that much on the gore, the physical gore. Rather, it dwells on the gore of perverse filial relationships. Here, the consumption of meat opens not only into incest, but into violations of filial duty, including matricide, right? Meat eating here is exposed as more than just an act of killing, right, which is a violent transgression. It is also, and perhaps even more abhorrently, as in the case of matricide, a relational transgression. So the consumption of meat, we might add, is more than just turning another subject into an object, the way we often hear it talked about. It is actually turning another subject into oneself. This erasure of the other's otherness is perhaps one of the most dumbfounding aspects of eating meat. And throughout the Chinese Buddhist sources, we see efforts to recall the erased subjectivity of those who have been eaten. In some cases, smell, it turns out, is the last lingering trace of that subject. And so it can function as a window through which to recover them. Consider, for example, the following commentarial passage by the Buddhist monk Xuan Hua. He says, "People smell like the food they eat. If they eat onions, they smell like onions. If they eat garlic, they reek of garlic. If they eat fish, they smell fishy. If they eat pork, they smell like pork. If they eat mutton, they smell like mutton. Whatever type of food you eat, you'll become incorporated with that food." So here we have a kind of Buddhist spin on the familiar maxim, you are what you eat, right? Except in this case, it is you smell like what you eat. When one subject eats another, the consumed being vanishes in almost every way, right? They can no longer be seen or touched or tasted or heard, but it turns out they can still be smelled through the body of the one who has consumed them. This points to the unique semiotics of smell. Because smell, as we have seen, right, is a material particle. An odor is an actual physical fragment of the odorant. A smell, in other words, does not represent the odorant in the same way that a symbol sort of abstractly represents that for which it stands. Rather, right, the smell, the odor, is the odorant itself. It is a material piece of the odorant itself. The smell of pork does not represent the pig. The smell of pork is a material piece of the pig. So one does not merely then smell like what or who one has eaten. More accurately, one smells of who one has eaten. So this then illuminates another dimension of this question. What is bad about bad smell? In the case of meat eating in Chinese Buddhism, the horror revealed by bad smell is not merely the violence of killing, but that of relational subjugation. The smell is horrific because it does not merely represent or stand for that subjugation. Rather, the smell is an instantiation of the subjugation itself. And this is why smell presents an acute risk of pollution. A bad smell does not merely symbolize impurity, right? Rather, the act of smelling is itself an act of contamination. And yet, the very same propensity for boundary crossing that can make smells materially polluting is also what gives them that relational potential we were discussing earlier, evident anytime we have a smell carrying, you know, particles of a fragrant offering from the human world into faraway celestial abodes. So then, to muddy the waters even further, it may be that, quote, bad smells, that is, the smells of contamination and improper relationships, and so-called good smells, those of connection and beneficial relations, are actually two sides of a single coin. Perhaps we cannot have the possibility of one without the risk of the other. So perhaps smells are not bad or good in and of themselves. After all, artisanal cheese and stinky feet do not merely smell similar, right? Bacterially speaking, their scent is identical. So what makes one good and one bad has less to do with their chemical composition than it does with matters of context and perspective. The same holds true in the Buddhist sources, where we see tons of examples of the relativity of smell. The Durgagama, for example, reminds us that just as we humans might find the feces-eating ghosts very stinky and unclean, well, actually, to the fine-nosed beings in the celestial realms, we humans actually smell, quote, stinky, filthy, and unclean, and we also smell like latrines and toilets. Very gross. The relativity of smell is not just that what smells good to one person might reek to another, but also that a single smell might actually be both good and bad at the same time. Take, for instance, the famous Ashubha meditations on the foulness of the body, right? The Bujing Xiang, or Bujing Guan in Chinese. These meditations instruct the practitioner to contemplate a rotting corpse, completely reeking with stench and impurity, as a means to gain insight. So in this case, a bad smell can become a vehicle for liberation. So our question then maybe should shift from what is bad about that smell to what might be good about it. In the case of the Ashubha meditations on the foulness of the body, it would seem that bad smells can be good if they help one gain insight into the truth about the way things really are, right? So in this case, a festering corpse might actually be a better smell than a sweet perfume that conceals the truth about the body and its impermanence. The Ashubha contemplations, in which bad smell becomes a vehicle for spiritual revelation, are emblematic, actually, of the larger Buddhist conviction that it's only by first recognizing the foulness of samsara that one can embark on the path toward liberation. So to recognize bad smells as bad is itself a good thing. It is, in other words, to see reality as it really is. In a wonderful essay about cleaning the family outhouse, the writer and poet John Berger has this enigmatic line. He says, "The stench of shit nags teleologically. To be sure, shit is definitely a kind of telos, or end point, in the very, very, very literal sense. Indeed, actually, if you think about it, all of the smells that we conventionally categorize as bad are the smells of endings in one form or another, right? The smell of digestion, the smell of decay, the smell of disease, the smell of death. What is discomforting about these smells is that they confront us so directly with the reality of change, of mortality, of impermanence. Yet, if in the Buddhist vision, unflinching recognition of these very facts of life becomes the first step toward liberation, then maybe bad smell is not so bad after all. Mahayana antinomian discourse, especially prevalent in the Zen tradition, the tantric traditions, takes this principle to an extreme, expressing liberation as immersion into vileness itself. "What is Buddha?" a student asked. "Dried shit stick," Zen master Yunmen replied. "What are the five sacred ambrosias that are extolled in some tantric traditions? They are urine, feces, blood, semen, and flesh. As the Heart Sutra, chanted daily in every Chinese monastery, insists with its relentless beat, there is no purity and no impurity." Right? In the Mahayana vision, breaking down false notions of pure and impure, good and bad, enlightenment and delusion, makes everything a potential gateway toward liberation. Even, and actually sometimes especially, those things that are conventionally thought of as bad. I encountered a powerful real-life example of this during my own ethnographic fieldwork at a Buddhist temple in Taiwan, where bad smell led to profound spiritual transformation. Wang Lei was a middle-aged temple attendee that I met during my fieldwork at a Buddhist monastery in Taiwan. On the last day of the Chinese New Year, we had all gathered for a celebratory dinner at a local vegetarian restaurant. Wang Lei was there with his wife and his two children. And over the course of the meal, I asked him, you know, what had led him to become such a devout Buddhist. Gesturing to his two teenage sons across the table, he told me, they used to be three. Wang Lei went on to recount the story of his infant son, who died suddenly and without warning. One day he was a very happy baby, he explained, and then very suddenly he was gone. In the weeks and months following their son's death, Wang Lei and his wife were awash in their grief. At first, they refused an autopsy, but because this was a case of child death from unknown causes, an autopsy was legally mandated. Wang Lei attended the procedure, but was unable to watch. I was in the room, he said, but I turned my back. At one point, though, I glanced over. As he spoke, Wang Lei covered his eyes with his hands, leaving a thin sliver of space between his fingers through which he gazed at me. And out of the corner of my eye, I saw my son cut open like this. Recreating the path of the surgical saw, he traced his fingers down his own body as though slicing himself in half, from between the eyes through the middle of the chest and down to his waist. The sight of his son cut in half clearly shook him, but it was what came next that was most harrowing. Shifting his tone to a grave whisper, he continued, "You know, there's a kind of smell." He paused. The moment I smelled that smell, I became vegetarian. So on the surface, Wang Lei's story might recall familiar arguments in Chinese Buddhism for the virtues of vegetarianism, right? Notably that it prevents the generation of killing karma, xia ye, and generates karmic merit. But I suggest this interpretation actually overlooks the most salient feature of Wang Lei's story, the fulcrum of which is the role of smell. Wang Lei's moment of moral transformation, right, the moment he committed to never again eat animals, was not occasioned by the sight, horrific as it must have been, of his son's disfigured body, but rather it was the smell. And what was that smell? It was the smell of animal meat. Wang Lei continued, "Years later, I worked across the street from a food stall where they barbecued meat. And every day that smell would waft into my workplace, and I always thought of my son." In Wang Lei's story, a repulsive smell became a gateway for moral transformation. In everyday life, you know, we tend to value human lives over those of non-human animals. Indeed, Buddhism, as you probably all know, is not infrequently accused of anthropocentrism, given its doctrinal insistence that human rebirth is the highest form of rebirth. But the teaching of rebirth also insists that all beings continually cycle through all the different realms of samsara, right? Such that every living being has at one time or another been one's mother, father, son or daughter, sister or brother, right? This vision of radical interconnection might ordinarily seem quite distant and abstract. But Wang Lei's olfactory revelation enabled him to experience it in a tangible way. When he realized the smell of his son's corpse to be the same smell as animal meat, Wang Lei may have caught a glimpse of something that Gananath Obeyesekere describes as the homology of species sentience, right? This idea that despite superficial differences of appearance, all living creatures participate in a common order of life. The smell revealed, right, not intellectually, but materially, sensorially, that the bodies of the animals we kill to eat are not different in kind from those of the family members that we love and cherish. By uncovering the commonality that underlies superficial differences of appearance, bad smell enlarged the scope of Wang Lei's connection with living beings. And this radically expanded the moral purview of his world. So what can we learn from bad smells in Buddhism? I'd say a first set of lessons has to do with the nature of smell, right? Smell, the sources suggest, is not just something that you do or something that you have. It points to something that you are. Contrary to the truism about sight, that you can't judge a book by its cover, actually, according to the Buddhist sources, you can judge a person by their smell. We see this illustrated throughout the Buddhist sources, for example, in the insistence that the Buddha himself smelled extraordinarily good, right? And that he never ever had produced a foul or bad odor. We could even read the canonical accounts of Queen Maya's perfumed womb as evidence of anxieties about the Buddha's proximity to the polluting smells of reproduction, right? So the fact that the Buddhist authors went to such lengths to sanitize the Buddha's olfactory existence demonstrates the very profound connection between smell and self in the Buddhist imagination. By virtue of its unique ability to carry particles at a distance, moreover, smell, perhaps more than any of the other senses, is a quintessential boundary crosser, as we have seen. Whether we like it or not, smells bridge self and other and shape the nature of relationships, a fact that's foregrounded, as we have discussed, in the Buddhist Vinaya. Smells can also bridge temporal, geographic, and even cosmological boundaries, as when odors carry offerings from the human realm to the celestial realms, or as when Wang Lei, through olfaction, glimpsed the permeability of human-animal boundaries. In all of these cases, smell functions as both the vehicle and the evidence of our relational entanglements. The boundary-crossing nature of olfaction reveals the inescapability of sociality, right, which carries a risk of contamination and the potential for meaningful connection. According to the Buddhist sources, it would appear that we cannot have one without the other. A final lesson we might learn from bad smell in Buddhism has less to do with smell than it does with badness. While the difference between good smell and bad smell initially seems self-evident, what we found is that this binary begins to dissolve as soon as we kind of examine it further. Even the baddest of all bad smells, like the universally repulsive smells of disease, decay, and death, can, in their very badness, reveal something that is arguably more true than what any good smell can convey. This is the truth of impermanence, of samsara, of reality. To drench a fetid corpse in perfume is not only futile, it's a dangerous denial of the way things are. So insofar as bad smells can unflinchingly reveal the reality of our existential condition, they can become, as we saw in the case of Wang Lei, a powerful source of insight. The Buddhist scriptures too blur the line between good and bad. The Avatamsaka Sutra, for example, tells us, when bodhisattvas smell putrid objects, they do not consider them stench. When they smell fragrant aromas, they do not consider them fragrant. When they smell both together, their minds remain equal, neither fragrance nor stench. If bad smell can lead one closer to reality, then bad becomes good. And when, as the Avatamsaka Sutra says, both good and bad are transcended, then one is simply left with the smell of reality itself. This may be another sense in which to recall Berger's phrase, bad smells nag teleologically. Perhaps the ends to which bad smells point are not just the ends of disease, decay, and death, right? Although those are part of it. Perhaps bad smell also points to an end in the more ultimate sense, right? Insofar as the Buddhist sources suggest that bad smell can be a path toward insight, then perhaps bad smell can draw us toward an end that is not merely a terminus, but in the true sense of telos, toward a sort of aim or aspiration. Thank you very much, everyone. I look forward to your thoughts, reactions, questions, and comments.